Hello there guys, it's me StrangeAngel9 again, and today I'm going to be talking about the Xbox One and the coming console generation, which basically we're talking about the PS4 and the Xbox One that has recently been announced. And the gameplay you're going to be seeing is a little bit of League of Legends on the PC. Also, I'm going to be talking about how I feel the PC fits into the next console generation and what's going to change, what's going to stay the same, what we can expect. So first, let's talk about a little bit about the Xbox One. The first thing that I got from the Xbox One press conference is that the Kinect is going to be, the Kinect was a K, not Xbox Kinect like Halo 2 Kinect, but Xbox Kinect, like the video device that records your movement, is going to be a much bigger part of the package that Microsoft is trying to give us. A lot of people said that they were focused on very casual gamers, and that it was going to be primarily an entertainment device. Now, let's just look at things logically here. What were they doing at this conference? They were releasing a console. They were basically showing us a first look at a console. Okay, now I think a lot of people got confused and thought this was going to be like an early E3. And of course, we were all hoping that it would be, and they were going to tell us about Halo 2 Anniversary and all these great games that we're going to come to expect. But I think that that's going to be mainly at E3. What we basically saw there was the hardware that we're going to be dealing with, which is the controller and the actual Xbox One. Now, the Xbox One was a moderate look. What's actually interesting about the Xbox One is I thought that they went back more towards a Xbox One, no joke intended or no pun intended there. They actually went back more towards a big box look, like the original Xbox, which is strange because it seems like the majority of consoles are trying to go for the small form factor, aka like Steambox or the Anya, whatever it's called, that's going to be by Amazon, or I don't even know where it's, but you know what I'm talking about. Pretty much, I mean, look at the Wii, look at the PS3, they're trying to go small form factor. And the Xbox One is actually going in the opposite direction, where it's a big console. Now, a lot of people have commented about its industrial look. I think it looks fine. I think that it is kind of weird, but there's going to be so many. I mean, look at how the Xbox 360's been. There's so many specialty console designs that this initial design is not something to really worry too much about. Now, in terms of hardware, what do I think about it? Well, I think in hardware, we've got some really good things coming on, because in hardware, we're talking about something that's using an AMD 8-core processor. Very similar in this respect to the PS4, but because now pretty much everybody's using an AMD processor. Now, AMD is a great company. I love AMD. I have an AMD 965 Black Edition in my PC at the moment, and I'm actually going to upgrade to a Vishera FX8350, which is AMD's flagship CPU at the moment. So AMD is really good. I love them. I think that they make good processors, so I feel really confident about this part of the design. The little bit I'm concerned about is what's the GPU going to be like, and what can we expect in terms of graphical performance. Now, obviously, I don't know all the system specs at this point, so that's going to be, I guess, it's kind of, that's to be seen, I would have supposed. One thing that I would say that I can tell you right now is going to happen is that we're not going to know what the console can really do for about a year, maybe 2 years even, because at the beginning, a lot of games are going to be primarily designed for the current generation and just going to be upscaled, you know, maybe some anti-aliasing or some anisotropic filtering. Because most of the BIOS currently have the current generation. By next year, and especially by the following year, we're going to have, you know, games that are dedicated for that console, and we're going to really start to see what that console can do. I do like this idea of If you look at the Xbox dashboard, it looks very similar to what we're used to. Maybe a few components of Windows 8, but still very, very similar. And I think that's a good thing because, I mean, look at the Blades design at the 360 launch to what it is now. Change is good in the sense of you want to keep updating your software, but you also want to start the console out with something that people are comfortable with, and I think that's what they're going for. So I think that's going to be really successful. Some of the really, really good news that I heard coming out of the press conference a couple days ago was that Xbox achievements are going to carry over, that you can basically talk to friends on the Xbox 360. Basically, you know, your Xbox Live experience continues, which is really important because I was worried about this a lot because, you know, I mean, I know that I have over 10,000 gamer score. I see some people that have like 30,000 gamer score. You spent so much time, you spent so much energy into that. And just to take those achievements and then if they were just thrown away would have been a real mistake. And I'm glad Xbox understood that. I'm glad Microsoft understood that and said, hey, no, we want your experience to continue in the 720 and for it to be a smooth transition. Now, what the sad news is the backwards compatibility is not looking good at the moment. And I think that a lot of us knew this to be the case. Ever since the like PS1, PS2 days, backwards compatibility has slowly been falling downhill to where less and less devices have that feature. And I think this has got a lot to do with just the hardware, the massive hardware differences that each console is having over its, you know, previous console. And so I think that's somewhat, I don't think we can do much about it, pretty much. I'll really miss, you know, Halo 3 and games like that that were just the very best of the console. And like Gears of War 1, Gears of War 2, those type of games. I will think it's a mercy. And what it's a mercy for is just ending the tyranny of Halo 4 and just basically cutting that abomination short, thank God. And so that's a really, really good thing. You know, definitely now until the console launch, we're not going to see too many big games. They promised that within the first year of the console's launch, the Xbox One will have 15 title exclusives. And I believe 8 of those will actually be new franchises, which is a big thing. Like I was talking about in my video with Drake, I was talking about me and Drake were basically discussing that console exclusives are very important to selling that particular console. And I think that PS3 and eventually PS4 is just not going to have this number of exclusives. And that's going to make you think, okay, what, when I'm buying the Xbox One, what am I getting that I can't get on other platforms? Which is very, very important. It's like talking about, you know, let's say when I'm talking about the PC, what am I getting that I cannot get on other platforms? Well, I'm getting games like StarCraft. I'm getting games like League of Legends. I'm getting a lot of these games that just simply are not done on the console and would be pretty much impossible. You know, maybe like, let's say, Counter-Strike for the majority part in the series, although there was an Xbox alteration, but it was just crap. So let's move on from that. But you see what I'm saying there is that it's these things that make you think, okay, what am I getting that I could not get if I was doing a PS4? Now, one of the most dubious things that has been, that we've heard some information about, but just a massive amount of conflicting reports, so I don't know what to think about it, is the whole used game bit and how used games are now going to have an activation fee. You know, everybody says this is for the gameplay developers, but just seeing so many of these developers produce free-to-play games, I just cannot believe that the developers at $60 a title cannot make money. I just don't believe that. So I think that's a very bad thing. We'll see how that pans out. I'm not trying to be too critical on it yet. Ghost Robo and a lot of other commenters on YouTube have really gone with the opinion that it's bad, that the console launch was bad, and that it's not catered to hardcore gamers, and that it's pretty much bad. And I really understand that mentality, because I do believe that they're talking too much about entertainment. But this was at the press conference. Let's wait until E3. Let's wait until we actually see, when the rubber hits the road, kind of metaphorically, and we see what games we're actually going to get. And I think that the entertainment aspects of the console is trying, is more of a Me Too philosophy, where every console is doing this. And so I don't really think that the entertainment features are going to be what defines the individual console. Probably the coolest thing that I've seen was definitely the Kinect support, because I think that's kind of going towards the dream of VR in the next couple consoles, where we're actually going to have a virtual reality, and it is progressing towards that, and I am really excited about that. I'm also glad that I waited on Kinect 1, because it sounded like the Kinect 2 is going to improve in virtually every capacity, and hopefully will start to be integrated in the games in some meaningful way, rather than it just kind of a tacked on thing that doesn't really work too well. So, if it doesn't work, it's best not to be implemented at all, if you know what I'm saying. So I'm very, very excited to see how that's going to come out. Playing League of Legends, where does the PC fit into this whole scheme of next generation? Well, PCs are in a really different league at the moment. There's two consensuses among the PC community. Number one, we're getting more and more games that aren't specifically built for the PC. We're getting more and more games that are specifically multi-platform. And this is not a good thing. I do not like this, because multi-platform, people say, well, that's a great thing. That how can that be bad? Because, if you have a multi-platform game, then it can attract more people, so it makes more money. Yeah, it's good in that sense, but why it's bad is because a PC game is going to be crippled if it's designed for the console, and not designed for the PC right from the get-go. Also, just from a user interface, one's using mainly auto-aim-based control systems, another using a mouse and keyboard. So, just to design games that are on the PC and on consoles is just not a good idea. Unfortunately, it's a reality that seems to be very prevalent at the moment. Where I think PCs is going to fit in, I actually think PC gaming is going to glow. And I know this just is shocking to people. Like, everybody's saying PC gaming is dying. And just look at anybody who has bought a PC and gotten into PC gaming for the last 10, 15 years, maybe even 20 years. Everybody's been saying the same thing for so long, it's ridiculous. PC gaming is dying. There's going to be no more PC games. It's just outrageous. It's not going to happen. League of Legends, Dota 2... Counter-Strike, Team Fortress, all these are examples. StarCraft, SimCity, all of these things. I mean, don't get me wrong, there's some real big problems, but these are showing that PC gaming is not going to die anytime soon. And the people that saying it are just console fanboys who don't really understand the issue. PC gaming offers you something completely different than console gaming. Not better. And I'm very specific about this. PC gaming is not better. It's just something completely different. And I think it's definitely an enjoyable experience. I think that it's one of those things that, PC gaming is, in its own right, very unique. So I think that it's just one of those things that you have to take it for what it is. And not try to make too many comparisons, because I think actually the comparisons, if anything, just hurt both consoles and PC. So let's not make comparisons. Let's just, PC gaming is PC gaming, console gaming is console gaming. Sorry guys for that little delay in the audio there. I had to do something, but anyway, back to the discussion at hand. Picking up right where we left off. So console gaming is console gaming, PC gaming is PC gaming. Where's the PS4 fitting into this whole equation? Pretty much, in my opinion, PS4 is not fitting into the whole equation. I think it's going to go the way of the Wii and the way of the, what is it, Wii U now? Or what is Nintendo's new system? In essence, it's going to become a secondary system, and I really think that the Xbox is going to take a huge share on the console side, and PC is actually going to gain some share overall. And here's the reasons why I believe this. Number one, one of the biggest things that we're seeing that is a dramatic indicator that the Xbox One, I start saying Xbox 360 automatically, the Xbox One has a huge advantage. Okay, let's just take a look at this and think about this, guys. So it's already been confirmed that on the Xbox One, Call of Duty DLC will come out earlier than PS3. Now, Call of Duty, and I know this is like, oh my god, he's talking about Call of Duty. Well, Call of Duty is the single most played FPS right now on consoles. So this right here is pretty much telling me that Activision is sinking, I believe Activision. What is it? I mean, there's so many different studios that develops Call of Duty. Anyway, beside the point, it's basically telling me that the number one console franchise is already knowing who the winner is going to be. And I just don't think, I really don't believe Sony. I love Sony products, but I do not believe the PlayStation, no matter what they do at this point, can honestly catch up to the Xbox and Microsoft, because I think they'll come out and it'll be fairly equal out of the gate. I really think PS4 will come out much better than people think, and it'll be fairly equal. But I believe a year or two down the line, when Xbox starts updating the software and PS4 stays, you know, relatively static, I think Xbox will start gaining an advantage. And by the end of this console generation, I think that you'll have, you know, the PS4 with maybe 20-30% difference from what it is at launch, and you'll have the Xbox One that is going to be like massively different from launch, and probably much to the superior. There'll be some things that are probably worse than at launch, but for the most part, it'll have improved a lot. And I think that the reason that PC gaming is going to pick up a little bit is because in PC gaming right now, what was the biggest problem with PC gaming? The biggest problem with PC gaming was the initial cost to get in it. And that cost is over time slowly decreasing, where, you know, you can buy a $500 or $600 system and still play League of Legends, still play StarCraft, still play some of these games. Now, you won't be able to play, you know, Crysis 2 or 3 at ultra resolutions, or Battlefield 3, you know, with 4 times anti-aliasing and 16 times anisotropic filtering, but you will be able to play League of Legends on a $500 or $600 system. Now, where does this come in? What impact does that have? Well, what impact that has is that basically, you know, there's more and more of these games that people are going to say, hey, these games are free to play. These games have a large community fan base. They're on Twitch. They're on YouTube. Maybe I should get into this because I don't have to pay, you know, console fees. I basically can, you know, listen to YouTube music. Actually, why the audio of this whole thing has been muted is I was listening to a playlist of some band, I believe. I don't know if it was Van Halen in this case, or if it was The Offspring, or Alice in Chains. That's the only way I can listen to music while I'm playing my PC game. It's just so amazing in that sense. So I think that the PC is actually going to gain profit and gain participants and gain part of the market share in this coming generation. I think Sony is going to lose a lot, and I think Microsoft is going to basically take over as the premier console, with the secondary one maybe being Steambox, because I think Steam really has, you know, its fingers on the pulse of the gaming community right now, and thus I think it may be able to compete relatively well. But it's tough to say. I mean, the Steambox may have a lot of software issues. I don't know how good Steam is at making hardware. I mean, what hardware have they made? So they may have these type of problems. This is what gives Microsoft just such a massive advantage. So right now I'm going to talk about what I thought about the Xbox One controller. And you're going to start hearing kind of a very similar concept as what I said about the Xbox. The Xbox One, you know, people say, well, why did they choose the name Xbox One? And this is almost unbelievable to say, but I really feel like the controller looks a lot more like the Xbox One controller did than the Xbox 360 controller. Now, this is an interesting decision because the Xbox One controller is very big, very bulky, not what I would think would, cater to the masses in essence. But it's a controller I did like personally, and therefore I think it's a good thing. I think the top part of it, the little fin design, is a little weird, but I'm not too worried about it because there's probably going to be aftermarket controllers that take this away. I don't see any real purpose to this. Maybe it has a function that I haven't seen yet. I'm not certain. But it's a pretty cool little device overall, and it doesn't look too freaky. It definitely doesn't look too insane. You know, and at least Xbox, we actually have seen the console right now. We don't even know what the PS4 is cooking up at this point. But I really think the hardware is going to be very similar. I think that the reason the 360, the 360 successor, the Xbox One, and I don't know what it is about it. I either say 360 because we've been in the 360 generation for so long, or I automatically jump my brain to the 720, because pretty much at this point, everybody's thought was it was going to be called the 720, and the 720 is just so ingrained somehow that I feel like it's going to take us like 2 or 3 years just to get used to Xbox One, which is, I think, probably the only bad choice that they made about the whole thing is the name, just because the 720 sounds more progressive. The Xbox One reminds people of the original Xbox, so it confuses people. I think what the marketing bit about that was, and why I think this is a classic example why I think marketing is stupid, is it was going to be the all-in-one entertainment box. The problem is that, you know, still, if people are going to buy an entertainment box, they're going to buy like a DVR or something. You know, this whole snapping to feature between things is okay, but, you know, a number of commentators had said, don't you have on your, you know, remote an input button where you can say, hey, I want to look at, you know, HDMI 2 or HDMI 1. So you can already do this. I mean, when are you going to be playing, you know, a game and just going to decide in the middle of the game, I want to go to TV? And a lot of other commentators have already said these points, that basically that's just a marketing hype thing, that it doesn't really add anything new. I think that it was like, oh, that's kind of nice, but it's nothing that is going to help me at all. What is the bad thing that I've noticed? And this is, I have to say, this is what I disagree. A lot of things I agree with what the other commentators are saying, but I disagree with one thing really, really heartily. And what I disagree with is the massive negativity that's come out about the Xbox One in particular and about the PS4 and just a new console generation. Because, you know, I really think it comes down to monetary things. To monetary factors. You know, everybody's saying like everything's negative. PS4 negative, Xbox One negative. You know, the new console, well, they should just stay with the Xbox 360. That is an insane idea. I don't understand how anybody can support that idea. That's completely crazy. The Xbox to Xbox 360 was noticeably shorter duration in terms of the console than was the Xbox 360 to Xbox One. It's already been pushed out, and they said that they're going to continue support for the Xbox 360 for a good while as the Xbox One comes out. So this idea that we should just keep with the Xbox 360 and that somehow we can squeeze more lifeblood out of it is just absolutely insane. I mean, the processor and the, you know, and the graphics card has been pushed so much now. I mean, literally, like, I remember there's, it's almost like a joke. There's an article talking about the GPU in the Xbox 360 and how it's like $40 now. You know, and, you know, most computer GPUs are between, let's say, like, you know, between $175 and, let's say, $400. So it's just absolutely crazy that people are saying that we should stick with a seven-year-old piece of hardware. It just makes no sense to me whatsoever. The only sense it makes is because we've been lured into this idea that consoles should be cheaper than they are. I mean, really, at $400 to $500, the Xbox One is going to be very competitive. It's running an 8-core AMD processor. I mean, I can tell you right now that my gaming PC was over $1,000. So it's half the price of that. Yes, it does have more limited performance, but it's, you know, noticeably less costly. I think that it's just one of those things that people are used to now, like $100 and $200 systems. This is the same thing that, let's say, if I was going to a movie. How much does a new movie cost? Let's say like $20, okay? So a new movie, a new DVD, you know, $15-$20. And so these people are saying, well, that's outrageous price. You know, DVDs should cost, you know, $5 when they're talking about a movie that came out 6 or 7 years ago. Well, yeah, those DVDs do cost $5. And it's the reason is because the movie's 6 or 7 years old. Just like the reason that the console is, you know, $150 now is because it's 6 or 7 years old. I mean, a new console is going to cost more. I just don't understand this idea that somehow this new console should have been like $200, you know, unless you're talking about something that's, you know, going to run the graphics of like 2003 or something. If, you know, if you want like graphics of the original Kingdom Hearts, then yeah, it can be, you know, $200. Not that those graphics are bad. But if what I'm saying is if you're going for the cartoony look like Nintendo is doing, that's the only reason that they can undercut the amount of money that their competitors are. If you want somewhat realistic graphics, you know, with advanced particle physics, you know, like let's say Battlefield 4 might bring into play and things of that nature, and, you know, environmental destruction, yeah, you're not going to get that for, you know, $150 if you're trying to break into the next generation and not just worried about doing what's already been done. So I feel like I've covered that point enough, and I know that the consoles are going to be difficult for some people to afford at the beginning, and that's why I think that they're doing a smart decision by saying, you know, hey, we're going to continue on the support for the Xbox 360 at the moment, and we're going to kind of try to bridge. That's pretty much what they're saying, is they're going to try to kind of bridge you over into the 720. Especially with the friends list being kind of synonymous, the achievement list kind of being synonymous. You know what I'm saying? They're trying to bridge people over, which is, I think, a really good decision. It would have been much worse if there was a big jarring gap. Because then let's say if I go over to the 720, but my friends are on 2 or 3 more months on the 360 because they have to save up money or whatever, it's going to make it much easier. So they definitely did a good decision here. You know, pretty much that's what I wanted to talk about in this video is PCs, consoles, where I think things are going. You know, I think that people are too focused on graphics too. This is a big thing that I want to talk about, is they're too focused on graphics. They're not worried about gameplay enough. And people say, well, the Xbox 360 can have better graphics. The reason that it needs to end, the reason that this console needs to end, is not because it has better, that it needs better graphics, but because the gameplay is being limited by staying with this console generation any longer. And I think I made my point about that. But it's just one of those things that I feel like people love the 360 so much. Like, it's been such a successful generation with so many just really kick-ass games. You know, it's unbelievable if you think about it. Like, we've had Halo 3, we've had Halo Reach, we've had Halo 4, we've had, you know, Gears 1, Gears 2, Gears 3, and Gears Judgment on one console. This is insane. Like the Xbox 360 was such an amazing console, but it is at a certain point you do have to you have to have this idea that yeah, the next console can be awesome as well, and that we shouldn't just stick to the 360 no matter what. Because I do believe it's really reached the end of its potential, and that I think that there's no like I don't feel the desire anymore to buy 360 games. I feel the desire to buy Xbox One games because I feel like 360 games, my favorite games on the 360, the ones that they really put a lot of effort into, have already been released. You know, Gears 1, Halo 3, Halo Reach, Gears, 2 and 3. Those are the games that they put a lot of effort into. Gears Judgment, I enjoy that game a lot, and that was probably the last great game of the Xbox 360. But it's just one of those things now you can tell that they're just subtly ramping down the amount of energy, the amount of effort that they're putting into 360 games at this point. Because, nobody's a fool. They're not going to release a game for a console that has like 4 or 5 months left. And then we're going to talk about the release date. Now, a lot of people are upset about the release date and why there wasn't a final release date, that we needed an exact date on which this console is going to release. Okay, I want you to just think about this for a minute. A lot of these people are going to be buying a console for somebody else at Christmas or buying it for themselves at Christmas. So what do you think the chances are it's going to launch after, let's say, December the 1st? I can tell you right now, the chances are virtually zero. There's no reason why it would launch after December the 15th by any measure, because then they would lose a huge share of the profits because people are going to buy other stuff for Christmas and not going to have any money left over. So the console is going to release between about November the 1st and December the 15th. That just makes classical sense. It's the only real option if you think about it, because they're going to want to try to, maximize the money. If they don't do this, it's a stupid decision. You look at some of the biggest games and when they're released, let's say of the last year. Okay, Halo, early November. Black Ops, a little bit later in November. The reason they do this is because they get both initial sales plus they get the Christmas sales. So it's a double whammy. It's a really good in terms of that's when people have saved up money and are going to buy something new. So, pretty much this idea that like we don't know when it's going to launch, we don't know the exact date, but if you had to have a 1 month range, we pretty much know when it's going to launch. Like, let's say a February 1st launch or something would just be completely insane. I don't see it, to be honest. And any earlier November would make no sense because then a lot of the hype, a lot of the newness would wear off. So I hope you guys kind of see what I'm talking about here. That like a lot of this, we don't know when the date's going to be, is really down to almost a level of semantics because we kind of do already know the date. We just don't know the official exact moment, but we pretty much know when the console's going to launch. I hope you guys have enjoyed this video. Tell me if you like watching some League of Legends gameplay. League of Legends is a little bit difficult to capture gameplay, and the reason that it is because the videos are just so long on 5v5, Summoner's Rift. However, I'm really enjoying League of Legends because I feel like I couldn't get into it at first because there's a notable strategy element, but once you kind of start digging into this game, it's really a lot of fun. And this is a great co-op game. And the thing is, because it's basically free to play, there's no reason why you should not try this game out. Like, it just makes no sense at all. So I'm gonna try to put a download link into the thing, which helps me out. It's a referral link, so if you guys can, if you do want to download it via that, because then it gives me points in game. It's pretty cool. I do like the system. A lot of things about this game are pretty badass. Like, you basically have one of the best communities that I've seen in online gaming, and the reason that they do is there's a good report system. There's what's called the honor system, which basically rewards good players for playing as a team and things of that nature. And there's basically a tribunal, which advanced players, once you play a certain amount of games, can go review other players' cases, get points for that, and basically kick out the people that are just basically not playing or, you know, doing things that are stupid to hurt the team. You get what I'm saying here. This game has really an advanced system and a very well thought out system, in my opinion. Actually, Xbox should take a few pointers from this game on how this should work, like in terms of how we need to ban people. If the Xbox Live system worked in this manner, I think there would be a lot better bans of people that really need to be kicked out of the game because they are, you know, cheating, the lag switching, they are basically hurting the gameplay experience for everybody else. So that's just my opinion on it. I hope you guys have enjoyed this gameplay. The last couple minutes to the win, and it is going to be a win on this gameplay, but just, you know, enjoy the last couple minutes of gameplay. I hope I gave you a lot to chew over. Basically, this was a commentary in two parts because it was so big. So sorry, guys, if the audio was a little bit different there at about the 15-minute mark, but I hope you guys have enjoyed this, and definitely leave comments, sub if you like the video, and tell me if you want to see more League of Legends. All right, this is Stranger Hydra 9 out.